Well, good morning, Dave. Thank you for inviting us into your home this morning. We're excited about being here. And we're here to talk about the hair mineral analysis. Do you quickly want to introduce yourself and how you got started with HMA?
Yes. Thank you for being here. Thank you for all the effort that you've gone through to make this tape possible. I appreciate it very much. I started using hair mineral analysis back in the 70s, shortly after I got out of college. And I was looking for a way to determine individual needs rather than treating symptoms of a patient. We were trying to determine the individual needs. And so I started researching the hair tissue mineral analysis. And I compared it to many different tests, other clinical tests, blood tests, and physical exams, x-rays, and so on. And but cut a long story short, eventually I started Trace Element Incorporated, or International Trace Element Labs, in 1984. Mm-hmm. And our headquarters is in Dallas, Texas, and we've been doing business in over 40 countries, and we have representatives in 28 countries.
It's amazing. It's amazing. So how, you know, I obviously do this stuff in Norway quite a bit. I mean, you're famous in Norway, and you have a large and a growing number of therapists working with your HMA system. And I'd like to go through the big parts of the report to better understand and to educate the people back in Norway.
Yes.
To what you're thinking and how you built up the report and why it is the way it is. So if we can start with the beginning and the absolute mineral levels, and to explain a little bit to us how you built up that graph.
Yes.
That technology.
Yes, we'll take each section of the graph individually, and the first section that we'll discuss here are the nutritional elements, and that's in the blue area here. And this is the most common elements that have been tested in the hair. They're most well-known. Mm-hmm. And basically the graph is divided into a dark blue area on the high side and low side, and a white area here. And this represents the white area represents the reference range of each element. And this reference range was based upon over 2,200 individuals,
okay.
And we did different countries as well. I forget the percentage of Scandinavia, okay. But it included a European population.
All right.
And it also included all age groups, and both sexes.
All right. So when we write sex and age on our patients on the hair sample, does that influence the reading here?
No, that's a good question, but no, the age is doesn't influence the results by
okay.
any means. What you get is what you get on the laboratory results, and
right.
it's not affected by age,
whether okay.
older or younger. However, the age and the sex does affect the report itself. When we do a report discussing the changes or the things that we find, the imbalances that we find, we try to relate that to age. In
okay.
other words, a child that's 3 or 4 years old would not have trends toward heart disease per se, like
right.
a person
right.
that was in their 60s. And then, of course, we separate the report to some degree between male and female characteristics. Certain
yeah.
things apply to a female that wouldn't apply
all
to
right.
a male.
Yeah. So the results you see here, they are the actual results that you measured on the test.
Correct. And we look at the elements relative to an individual's and where they, you know, typically would fall within this reference range. That's sort of the ideal.
Hmm.
And so we're able to compare individual results to this reference interval. And on like this sample here, we can see that the calcium is quite low relative to the reference interval on this individual, and so it's quite readily seen that person has a deficit. And then, of course, on the opposite end, if a person had an extremely high level, that would be showing up in this dark blue area, and the blue area just basically indicates how far outside of the reference range that mineral is.
Yeah. So you know, you've seen a lot of these tests, obviously.
Mm-hmm.
What would be the most alarming things you see in that section of the test? Is there something that in your mind stands out as more alarming, or is is anything just differences?
I would say the most alarming pattern I would see is in a child.
Okay.
In other words, when we see major disturbances in these patterns in a child, to me that's the most alarming thing to see compared to an adult.
Yes.
Because it means that whatever condition that adult may be susceptible to, that child is susceptible. And one of the questions I get is, well, what's the most serious mineral deficit that you might see? And I think probably the most serious deficiency would be a magnesium deficiency.
Okay.
Because of the potential that that has on association with heart attacks and so forth. So it could a person could very well succumb from a severe magnesium deficiency.
Okay.
You know, due to cardiac abnormalities. And but I am more concerned when we see a major imbalance in a child. Particularly since their nervous system is so sensitive to insults, from the environment, heavy metals, environmental chemicals, and so forth. And so even before birth, they're going to be influenced somewhat with these things via the mother. So, and then after birth, obviously, then the development of the nervous system, it takes a while to develop and during that development is very sensitive to outside influences, and therefore it can really have imbalances, and heavy metals can really harm a child in the long run.
So when you say that low levels of magnesium is a serious indication for you, how low are you here then when you really?
Well, that would depend on the person, but when you're getting down here like halfway between the beginning of the reference range and here, when we're getting about halfway there, that would be considered a very serious magnesium deficiency.
I see. Okay. And on the high side, how high do a column go before you? Oh, that's really high.
Mm-hmm. Well, that's interesting. It all depends on each element. Some elements, have more of a significant meaning if they're high than others. For example, when we look at these nutritional elements, now some of them in excess can become toxic.
Yeah.
And the toxic elements in that range are copper, iron, and when those become excessively high, that's quite alarming.
Okay.
And it may not have to be very high, but the imbalance could be a major contributor to abnormalities associated with that, an excess iron or copper or manganese or chromium. When it gets high, it becomes toxic. So, like calcium being elevated, it's not as serious, an immediate seriousness compared to like if iron was high or manganese was high.
So the worst thing is high copper and high iron and in the main panel here.
Right, and manganese.
And manganese.
And potentially chromium.
All right. And the worst deficiencies are magnesium.
Yeah, magnesium is probably the primary one because of the impact that it can have on, a sudden heart condition. And then there's others, copper deficiencies, when it gets below one milligram percent, when we see a copper level getting below one, then I always consider that a rather serious indication of potential problems in the future because, again, that is related to collagen formation, collagen, structural integrity, and so forth, and therefore, you have the predisposition toward disorders related to it, like aneurysms, strokes, and so on.
So copper is important, and I think that's one of the questions I've gotten from some of the therapists. Is is it safe to subscribe? To have patients take copper, and the standard answer we give is, of course, if you are deficient, you need to take it. But I know other doctors are concerned about giving copper. Do you have any special comments around that topic? Or
now, that is a question that we hear often. But you see, the point is that we're not giving this long term. You know, we want to retest a person after they've been on therapy in case they are getting too much copper, and then we can make modifications in those recommendations depending on their response.
Yeah. So it's important to bump the level, but it's important to also get off it before you elevate it. Yeah.
Correct.
All right. Well, thank you very much, Dave. I think we'll finish the discussion on the main nutritional panel or the main nutritional elements now. And we'll pick it up again with toxic elements shortly.
Okay, very good.
Thank you.